time to give your heart. Come just as you are to worship. Come just as you are before your God. Come.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you.
The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Oh, come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
Welcome to New Hope Online. We are so delighted and encouraged that you have chosen to spend a few minutes with us watching this week's message. We are in this series of messages on the disciples that Jesus methodically handpicked to become his disciples. Now today we are going to study about the disciple Philip. And the Gospel of John is the only Gospel writer that mentions Philip in his Gospel. And we find his story in John chapter 1, verses 43 through 45. And this is what it says. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Verse 45, Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, as we bow our heads and our hearts in your presence, I pray today that you would speak to us and through us. Give your word a free course to travel, and may it find a lodging place in the hearts of people today. Meet the needs of your people. Hide us in the cross of Calvary that people might see Jesus. And I pray this prayer with a humble heart, a grateful heart, and in the name of Jesus, amen. Talking today about Philip, one of the 12 disciples that Jesus chose to be his disciples. There's a story about Billy Graham, an interesting story, which I will be referring to a little bit later on in this message, but an entrepreneur was introduced at a banquet as one of the most gifted businessmen in the nation. And this was evidence, the MC said, by the fact that the man had made $1 million on California oil. When he got up to speak, the guest of honor seemed a bit embarrassed. He said the introduction was somewhat correct, except it wasn't oil, it was coal, and it wasn't California, it was Pennsylvania. And it wasn't $1 million, it was $100,000, and it wasn't him, it was his brother. And he didn't make it at all, he actually lost it. Other than that, the introduction was absolutely factual. Now, I want you to know something. That MC that gave that introduction, well, the disciple called Philip was not like that at all, because Philip, I refer to him as the administrator of the 12 disciples, and some people refer to him as a bean counter. I actually refer to him as a calculating, skeptical disciple. Now, sometimes people do refer to him as Philip the bean counter, and that's okay, but it kind of reminds me of Sandy Gross, who used to be a member of our church before she passed and went on to heaven, and she used to count the money after the services was over. She would empty the offering box. Well, this other guy in our church, his name was David Morris. He was married to Marilyn Morris, and that fine, wonderful couple also has since passed and went on to heaven. But Sandy and David and Marilyn were very committed Christians while they were at New Hope, and Sandy connected with Jesus at New Hope. But anyway, when David saw Sandy emptying the offering box, he began to tag her as Sandy the bean counter. And so that was rather comical to listen to. But Philip, let's talk about Philip today. He was a facts and figure kind of a guy. He was analytical. He had a lot of melancholy in his personality. He could be cynical. He could be negative. And Philip was the guy that could always see why things just wouldn't work, why it couldn't be done. Now, we've talked about two disciples thus far. We've talked about Peter. Last Sunday, we talked about Andrew. And today, we're going to be talking about Philip. Think about it, folks. 250 million people on the face of the earth at that time. And Jesus, methodically, filled with the Holy Spirit, had in mind the criteria that he wanted as he looked for his 12 disciples. And so he picked, out of all of these people, 12 men. Now think about that for a moment. 12 men were handpicked by Jesus. And now today, millions and millions, if not billions of people, have become followers of the way. Truly devoted followers of Jesus. But it all traced back to just 12 men. Let that sink in for a moment, folks. That is awesome. It all started with just 12 men. Now, I want you to see some things in the life of Philip, and I'm sure that you can relate to Philip as we unfold the story before you today about his life. I know I see myself in each one of these disciples. I also see myself in the life of Philip. First of all, I want you to see his call. I want you to see his call. See, the day before, the Bible says Jesus had called two fishermen, Andrew and Peter. And the next day, he goes and he finds Philip. The scripture literally says that Jesus found Philip. Now, there's three things I want you to see right at the outset of this message, folks. Number one, I want you to notice that it was Jesus who found Philip. Jesus found Philip. You know, I've heard it said before, I'm sure you have too. People are rejoicing over the fact that they have found the Lord. Well, I got news for you. You didn't find the Lord. He wasn't lost. He found you. The Bible says he came to seek and save those who were lost. Years ago, there was a movement in the church culture called the seeker-friendly churches. And they were trying to change their mythology to attract the seekers. Well, I had problems with that kind of thinking then, and I still do today, because Jesus, folks, listen, Jesus is the seeker. He came seeking and looking for Philip. And Jesus is in the business today, folks, of going on a search, seeking to find you. And so the Lord found Philip. Philip didn't find Jesus. Jesus found Philip. Very interesting. Now, Billy Graham was having a crusade on one occasion, and he was in town, and he needed to find the post office. And it was a strange town in which he was in on that day. And he saw on the side of the road a little boy. And so he approached the little boy, and he said, "Son, can you show me where the post office is?" And the little boy said, "Sure, I can." He said, "You go down this road, hang a right, then go a couple of blocks, hang a left, and there you will find the post office." And so Billy Graham said, "Son, I want you to come to my crusade tonight. I'm going to tell you how you can find heaven. I'm going to tell you how you can find heaven." And so he asked the little boy, "Will you be there?" Little boy said, "No, I'm not coming." And Billy Graham said, "Why would you not come to my crusade?" And the little boy said, "Well, sir, you couldn't find the post office. How are you going to find heaven?" Well, do you ever think about the fact that the first question that was ever asked in the Bible came from the lips of God himself? It's found in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 9, where God said to Adam, "Where art thou?" First question asked in the Bible came from the lips of God. Let me tell you something, folks. God knew where Adam was, but he wanted Adam to know where he was. And God knows where you are. God knows where I am. But God wants us to know that we know where we are. Now, I want you to know something. The very first question asked in the New Testament is found in Matthew 2, verse 2. Look what it says. Where is he? That's the question. Where is he that is born King of the Jews? And so we have to realize, folks, that God has a part and we have a part. Philip. Now, he was a calculating, skeptical, bean counter disciple. He was analytical. He had a lot of melancholy in him. And so the question behooves us to ask is, why did he just immediately follow the Lord without any hesitation? You might say, well, maybe Peter and Andrew had something to influence him about that, because all three of them were fishermen. But I believe there was more than that, because if you look at John chapter 1, verse 45, the Bible says, Philip goes and finds Nathanael, and he says, Nathanael! Now, Philip and Nathanael were close friends. They were buddies. He says, Nathanael, we have found him, of whom Moses in the law, Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, you know. Moses in the law writes about him, the prophets did write about Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now, let me tell you something. Philip, having that analytical mind, he studied the Old Testament prophecies. And he knew that 300 Old Testament prophecies referred to Jesus. And so, without a doubt and without any reservation, Philip knew that Jesus was the Messiah. And I want you to notice that Jesus found Philip. I want you to see something else. Number two, Philip then found Nathanael. We see that in John chapter 1, verse 45. Now, Nathanael, as I said, was his friend. They were buddies. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, We have found him, of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now, let me tell you something, folks. Listen up. An indicator that a person has found the Lord is that they want to find somebody else that they can influence, that they can help connect to Jesus. That's an indicator, in my opinion, that a person is a Christian. An indicator that we are Christians and we're living the way we should by God's values in His book, then we want to go and find somebody else that we can influence and try to connect to Jesus. Jesus, in an individual approach, was seeking to find people who were lost. 31 people came to Jesus in an individual approach. What I mean by that is not someone speaking to masses of people, but 31 people, and 26 of them were brought by somebody else. 31 people, but 26 of them were brought by somebody else. George Barna did a survey not too long ago, and it revealed that why do people come to church? And overwhelmingly, 86% of those who were surveyed said they came to church because they were invited by a friend. And that's exactly what Philip did after Jesus found him. He went and found Nathanael. Now, Philip, he found the secret to the Christian life. Philip found the secret to the Christian life. And folks, do you know what that secret is, even to this day? Well, it's in the Bible. And my motivation for giving messages, folks, is for you to get to know your Bible. Look at this verse in John chapter 1, verse 43. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He followed Philip. He found Philip and said to him, Follow me. So, Jesus went seeking, and he found Philip, the scripture says, and he said to Philip these two words, Follow me. Philip now was the very first person that Jesus ever said, Follow me. Very first person Jesus said, Follow me. Now get this. Jesus now is at the end of his ministry and he's talking with Peter. Now we all know the story of Peter. he messed up big time. Peter denied the Lord. He went to cussing. He hung out with the wrong crowd. I mean, he really made a mess of his life at that season in his life. But now look what John chapter 21, verse 22 says about the dialogue that Jesus was having with Peter. Jesus said to him, "If it is my will that he remains until I come, what is that to you, Peter? You follow me." You see, in the context of this verse, Peter was all concerned about what John was going to do. And Jesus, in essence, said, "Peter, it's none of your business what John's going to do. You follow me." And so, look at those two words, "follow me." At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, when he was picking out his 12 men to be his disciples, he found Philip and he said, "Follow me." And now at the end of his ministry, he says to Peter, "Follow me." Folks, I've got to tell you something. Now, we get into trouble when we lose our focus and we take our eyes off of Jesus. We get our eyes on something else. We get our eyes on somebody else, some situation, whatever it is, and we have a tendency sometimes to lose our focus, and we get our eyes off of Jesus. And when we do that, well, we get into trouble. And so the secret to the Christian life, folks, is keeping on following Jesus. Keep your eyes on Jesus, not any individual, not any situation, not any circumstance, but just keep your eyes on Jesus. Don't lose your focus. Just follow Jesus. And that's the secret to a victorious Christian life. When I was a teenager, we used to sing this song, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." You know, folks, as a kid, as a teenager, wow, I've sung that song so many times, but I never knew the story behind that song. Do you know where that song originated from? Well, let me tell you something. That wording to that song came from India. After the Welsh Revival, missionaries were sent abroad, and some missionaries went into India. One missionary in particular went into northeastern India, and in that part of India, there was a village, and they had never heard of the gospel before, and they were very, very violent people. They, in essence, were headhunters. And this father and mother and two boys listened to this missionary tell them about Jesus, and they decided to accept Christ into their life and into their family, and they received Jesus. Well, this father and mother, two sons, heard the gospel story from a missionary, and they decided to follow Jesus. They said, "We will follow Christ." And when the chief heard about it, he brought them out in front of the whole village, and he said, "You've got to renounce this faith and this name, this new name that we've never heard before. You've got to renounce this faith." The father said, "I'm sorry, but I have decided to follow Jesus." And the chief was angry, and he said, "If you don't renounce your faith, my archers are standing by, and they will shoot arrows at your two sons and kill them." Father said, "I have decided to follow Jesus," and his two boys were shot with an arrow and were killed. The chief said, "Now, sir, you have got to renounce this faith." And the father said, "I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. And the chief said, if you do not renounce your faith, then we are going to kill your wife. Father said, I have decided to follow Jesus. And the bow and arrow struck his wife and killed her. And she and her two sons were laying dead at his feet. And the chief stepped up and said, now it's just you, and if you don't renounce your faith, we're going to kill you. The father said, looking up into the heavens, he said, I have decided to follow Jesus, the cross before me, the world behind me. And so, refusing to renounce his faith, he also was killed. Chief gave the order, and that family, father, mother, and two sons, were killed because they did not renounce their faith. And so, the testimony of history of that village is that because of this couple, this family, refusing to renounce their faith, saying, the father did, I have decided to follow Jesus. The villagers wanted to know more about this man called Jesus. And the chief himself became a follower of Jesus, and the whole village became followers of Jesus, all because one man, one family, one mother, and two boys who said, we have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Are you with me, folks? Are you taking notes? Are you paying attention? I hope that you are. Though none go with me, I will follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. And so you see, folks, we've got to make up our mind. I am not going to let anything stop me from following Jesus. As a young teenager at a youth camp on the outskirts of Walla Walla, Rutan camp, I kneeled at the altar and I gave my life to Jesus. And that's where I started my spiritual journey. And now I'm coming into the sunset years of my life. And since I made that decision as a teenager, to this day, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. And my life, to be sure, has had its ups and downs. It's had its detours. It's had some failures. But we serve a God who is gracious to forgive us when we mess up, just like Jesus did with Peter. And so I am determined that I'm not going to let my frustration stop me. I'm not going to let my enemies stop me. I'm not going to let my discouragement stop me. Folks, I'm not going to let anything stop me because I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I see Philip's call. The second thing I want you to see here is his calculating. His calculating. We have this story found in John's Gospel. He's the only one that writes about Philip. John chapter 6. Look what it says in verse 5. Lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, I believe that Philip perhaps was the administrator of the 12 disciples. Jesus said to Philip, where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat? His disciples, some of them wanted Jesus to send the crowd away, empty. Jesus says, no, we're going to feed them. How are we going to do it, Philip? Jesus, I'm paraphrasing now. I have fun studying the Bible. I find a tremendous amount of joy studying the Bible. And sometimes I use my imagination. Jesus might have said to Philip, where are we going to buy bread? Should we go down to the Dairy Queen? Or should we go to the Chick-fil-A? Or should we go down and get some of those Happy Meals? Or should we go down to the $5 combo and get some of those? Better yet, Philip, why don't we maybe go down to the Red Lobster and get some of those cheese biscuits? Wow! But look what the next verse says. Verse 6. He said this to test him, for he himself knew, Jesus knew, what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get just a little. Jesus looked out on the crowd. The Bible numbers them 5,000, but I happen to believe if there's 5,000 men there, there's got to be some women around. And if there's some good-looking men in the crowd, which I believe they were, then there's some women there, and then you have some children there also. So they could have been as many as 15,000 in that massive crowd of people, but the Bible numbers them as 5 men. They said, Lord, it would take 8 months' wages to feed this group. There's no way, absolutely no way that we can feed this group of people. It can't be done. Philip, with his calculator, it just doesn't pencil out, Jesus. Verse 10, Jesus said, have the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Verse 11, Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. Now here's the message, folks, in this story right here, before the miracle took place. Notice what Jesus did. Jesus gave thanks. Somebody said, boy, after God does it, I will praise him. Oh no, that's not the way it works. We praise him before he does it. And there's a better chance of him doing it. He gave thanks before it happened. He gave thanks before he fed that large crowd of people. Verse 11, Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. Wow, what a story. Philip, the calculating, skeptical disciple, had his calculator in hand, and he got into trouble again because he took God out of the equation. Always remember this, folks. Philip was analytical. You may be analytical yourself. Philip had a lot of melancholy in him. You may have a lot of melancholy in you. But don't get so analytical, don't get so detailed that you take God out of the equation. That's when we get into trouble, folks, when we eliminate God from our life and from our situation. Always keep God in the equation. If you remember nothing else about this message on Philip, remember this. Always keep God in the equation. Why you say that, Dale? Well, because Ephesians 3:20 says, now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. And look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Somebody says, I'll see it, then I'll believe it. Folks, that doesn't work. That's not the way it works. You've got to believe it before you see it. If you don't see it before you see it, you'll never see it. Now that's a profound statement, folks, but it's true. If you don't see it before you see it, you'll never see it. Always bring God into the equation. Way back in the winter of 1987, I met with just a handful of people that were wanting to start a new church called New Hope Christian Fellowship. Just a handful of people. We had no money. A handful of people, and maybe there were three or four out of that small handful of people that were really, really committed to this cause. And I said to that small group of people, I have the faith to believe that God will send people into our church whose faces we have not seen, whose names we do not know, and many of them will come with a broken heart. And so our mission as a church is to heal hurts and build dreams. And folks, now, 34 years later, I could write a book, and maybe I will someday, of the hundreds and hundreds of people that were drawn to New Hope by the Holy Spirit, and they came with a broken heart, and God healed that hurt and instilled a new dream in their lives. And they have moved on. That's been our mission over these 34 years. You say, Dale, there's absolutely no hope for me. My situation is hopeless. I say, no, it isn't. As long as you bring God into the equation. You say, Dale, my marriage is a mess. It's hopeless. I say, no, it's not. As long as you bring God into the equation. Studying the life of Philip, I see his call. I see his calculating. Number three, I see his confusion. We have this account of Philip's life in John chapter 12, verses 20 through 22. Now, there were certain Greeks among those who came up to worship at the feast. Verse 21, then they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip came and told Andrew. Now, why did he do that? He was confused. He came and told Andrew, and in turn, Andrew and Philip told Jesus. Now, is there a Jew in that crowd? No. It said certain Greeks among them. Bible scholars say among that crowd of Greeks, there was a man by the name of Luke. Well, you know what that tells me? We all are Gentiles. In biblical times, the Jews looked at the Gentiles as dogs, unclean, uncircumcised. They had nothing to do with the Gentiles. And that's how we would have been looked on. So get this. They came to Philip. Now, why did they come to Philip? Philip had a Greek name, and his Greek name means lover of horses. And so they went to him thinking that they could be more comfortable talking with him because he had a Greek name, and they were Greeks. They were Gentiles. Verse 21. Then they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, Sir, we would wish to see Jesus. They just wanted to see Jesus. In some pulpits, pastors have placed that phrase on the pulpit. We would see Jesus. Anyway, look what Philip did. He came to Andrew. See here, the calculating that he was doing got him in trouble again. Peter had to overthink things. Philip. Philip had a tendency to overthink things. Some people are just like that. I even, truth be known, have some of that in me. I tend to overthink things. A lot of people are like that. They tend to overthink everything. You think people are always talking about you? No, they're not. I just know they're talking about me. No, they're not. You're overthinking, folks. The post that was just posted, that was all about me. No, it wasn't. You're caught up in overthinking. You overthink everything. Even you go to a football game and the team is huddled up. I just know they're talking about me there. No, they're not. Somebody asks now, why should he just bring them to Jesus? Well, because in John 6:37, see, Philip was confused, so he has to go talk to Andrew. Why didn't Philip just bring them to Jesus? John 6:37, Jesus said, whoever comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. But because they were Gentiles, Philip was confused. Now, let me tell you something, folks. If you are a Christian, and I believe that you are, we better get comfortable with people that are different from us. We had better get comfortable with people that are different from us. I've learned over the years, folks, that everybody that is a Christian is not going to look just like me, they're not going to dress just like me, and they are not going to talk just like me. Everybody that's a Christian is not going to act like me. Now, folks, to be honest with you, there's a lot of things that are not my preference. Howsoever, but for me, to unchristianize them is so wrong, folks. Something may not be my preference. The music, for example, some of the modern music, that's not my preference. But for me to unchristianize them, it's wrong. Let me tell you something, folks. If you are a Christian, I believe that you are, better get comfortable with people who are not just like you. They may not look like you. They may not talk like you. They may not act like you. One wife said to her husband, will you love me when I'm old and gray? And he said, honey, I've loved you through four shades. Now, folks, I came along when it was brunettes, blondes, redheads, and grays. Remember those years? I sure do. Get real, folks. Get real, real. Now, it's blue. It's green. It's purple. And it's orange. All I'm trying to say, folks, people can be a Christian and not look like us, talk like us, act like us. You say, well, Dale, what's heaven going to look at? Well, the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, after these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number of all nations. Hold it right there. A Chinese Christian will be there. The Japanese Christians will be there. The African American Christians will be there. The Filipinos will be there. People from India who are Christians will be there. Caucasians will be there. Of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes with palm branches in their hands. Those are the ones that Jesus came for, and those are the ones that God loves. I like listening to J.D. Jakes. And one time J.D. Jakes said, the black Doberman pincher, he learned how to get along with the white Doberman pincher, and the goldfish has learned how to swim with the bluefish. Folks, God help us if the animal kingdom has more intelligence than we do. God help us if the animal kingdom has more intelligence than we do. I want to tell you something, folks. I'm just a small voice in the wilderness crying out. But we ought to let and tell the media your days of playing us against one another, they're over. They're over. Somebody says, well, he's a great leader. Folks, I have become a student of John Maxwell and his leadership seminars. And out of that seminar one time, I heard him say, and I have repeated it repeatedly ever since, he's not a great leader if all he or she can do is to divide people. Great leaders bring people together for a cause. They don't divide people. They bring people together for a cause that's bigger than they are. Philip, what have we learned so far? We've talked about his call, talked about his calculating that got him into trouble, talked about his confusion, and number four, as I wrap up this message, let's talk about his complacency. His complacency. In John chapter 14, Jesus said, I'm going away. You have read this many, many, many times. John chapter 14. Let not your heart be troubled, but you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you so. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So Jesus is telling his disciples, he's also talking to Philip. And look what happened. Verse 7. He addresses Philip. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also, Philip. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Verse 8, Philip said to him, Lord, just show us the Father, and it's sufficient for us. Look at verse 9. I think Jesus was a little disgusted at the skepticism of Philip. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? Here's what he said. I think, my goodness, Philip, dumb and dumber. Philip, we've ate together. We've walked together. We've prayed together. We've slept in the same area together. We've traveled together for 3.5 years. And you mean to tell me you don't know who the Father is? Dumb and dumber! Don't tell me that Jesus didn't get frustrated sometimes with these guys. I believe he had times when he just wanted to slap them along the side of the face in Jesus' name. You want to know what the Father is? Jesus says, look at me, because I and the Father, we are one. Folks, you want to know what God the Father looks like, is? Look at Jesus. Here's what's interesting. If you study the book of John, hang with me, I'm just about finished. The word know is used 141 times. But you've got to understand something, that there's four levels to that word know. Level number one, you can know in fact. What I mean by know in fact is, I know there's a God. In fact, I know there's a God. That's know number one, level number one. Level number two is when you know and you understand the truth behind the fact. That is to say, I know God, and I know that Jesus was sent from God to die on the cross for our sins. You can know God as a fact. You can know the truth behind the fact. And you can still be lost, as last year's Easter egg. You really can. Being an American does not make you a Christian. Being raised in a Christian home does not make you a Christian. Somebody says, we're all God's children. Where did that come from? That's not found in the Bible. You need to get that out of your head, folks. That is simply not true. We are not all God's children. We are all God's creation, but we are not all God's children. You can know and understand the truth behind the fact. You can know the fact. But both of these levels, one and two, you can still be lost. Level number three is to know in relationship. John 17, verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Genesis chapter 4, verse 1 says, Adam knew Eve. What does that mean? It simply means to know in relationship. It means you have accepted Christ and you have a relationship with Him. Now there's a fourth level. The fourth level is you can know Him in a deeper relationship. Salvation is about going to heaven. Howsoever, submission is about heaven on earth. You want to know what heaven on earth looks like? Well, it's level number four. It's when you submit. You say to God, I want to know you. I want to know you in a deeper level. Now think about this. You had parents, either good or bad. You had parents, but you really didn't really know them until you grew up and you matured. Folks, a lot of people would never know the Lord in a deep way because they never grow up. They're constantly wanting the bottle, but they never get the milk of the Word. They just want the bottle and the pastor to book them on the back as they leave the sanctuary. But there's so much more. God wants you to know Him in a deeper way. How do you get that, Dale? Well, look at Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. Paul writing, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being conformed to His death. Paul said, I gave my life to Christ on the Damascus Road. But I want more than that. I want to know Him. I want to know the power of His resurrection. I want to know that power that brought Jesus out of the grave. I want that power operating in my life, because if I experience that power operating in my life, I can overcome anything. I just want to know Him in a deeper level. I want to know that power in my life. I want to know Him and the fellowship of His sufferings. I am willing to suffer, Paul was saying, if it will make me more like Him, being conformed to the image of His death. I want to know His power, even if it means suffering, that I may become more like Him. Now, folks, as I conclude my message today, there's one thing I know for sure. All of us are on one of these four levels. How many of us are like Philip, hanging with Jesus for 3.5 years and yet still didn't know who the Father was? We can hang around the church. We seldom open our Bibles. And we can live our life just knowing about the facts, and not really knowing power of His resurrection and knowing Jesus on a deep level. One of us, all of us, are on one of those four levels. So let me ask you a question, and then I'm done. When you die, and you will, do you know for sure that you have a home in heaven? You say, well, Dale, the truth would be known. I really don't have peace in my heart. I don't know for sure that if I die, I will go to heaven. But I sure would like to know. Well, let me show you how you can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that when your time on this short-lived life on this earth is over, you have a home in heaven. It's by praying a simple prayer. And on the screen, just follow along and pray with me as we pray this prayer together. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner, but God, I am sorry for my sin. I'm so sorry. I want to change. I believe that you died on the cross for my sin, and I confess them to you right now. Come into my heart. Come into my life and forgive me now. And now, Lord, I thank you. I thank you, God, for forgiving me. Thank you for coming into my life. Thank you for saving me. Now, folks, I want to give you a final thought. Always keep God in the equation. Always keep God in the equation. And don't take your eyes off Jesus. Learn to sing that song, I have decided to follow Jesus. The Bible says, if we draw nigh unto God, He will draw nigh unto you. And keep God in the equation.
To follow.